Hello all, I am Dr. Aisha Zanib, Associate Professor, Department of Civil Engineering, Rajagiri School of Engineering and Technology. In this lecture, we will be dealing with parabolic arches, which is a part of analysis of arches. Module 6, Structural Analysis 1, S4 BTech Civil Engineering. So let us see the analysis of three hinged arches. First is the parabolic arch. So as shown is the parabolic arch. Okay, so let L be the total span of the arch, YC be the rise of the crown from the support or the springings. Okay, so from this horizontal line up to the crown, that is vertical distance, is given as YC. Y is the rise of the arch at the section XX. So if we cut any section XX, let Y be the distance from vertical distance from the support to the cut section. Okay, and let X be the horizontal distance from the support to the cut section. And let theta be the angle, the tangent that XX makes with the horizontal. So now in order to get the profile of the arch, that which is an equation of a parabola, we usually write it as Y proportional to X into L minus X. Or we can write Y is equal to KX into L minus X, where K is the constant of proportionality. Let this be equation 1. Now we know at Y is equal to YC, X is equal to L by 2, because the hinge is at the mid-span. So substituting X is equal to L by 2 in this equation, we will be getting YC is equal to K into L by 2 into L minus L by 2. Or K is equal to 4YC by L square. So the equation of the parabolic profile is Y is equal to 4YC by L square into X into L minus X. Now again we can always find out that angle theta from the equation tan theta is equal to dy by dx, which is equal to d by dx of 4yc by L square into x into L minus x. Now 4yc by L square is a constant, we can take it outside. So d by dx of x into L minus x is nothing but L minus 2x. So thus we can find out the angle theta. Now in order to get the internal forces at any cut section, let us draw the free body diagram of the cut section. Okay, so as we know there will be HA and VA at the support as the reactions, and at the cut section at X, either we can write the reactions as two mutually perpendicular components which are horizontal and vertical, which we can write as HX and VX. Now if you see this figure, we can directly get the from the equation of equilibrium what is VX and what is HX. Even if we are having a load, we can add up that load also into the equation of equilibrium. Now instead of showing this components at the section, the whatever that reactions are there at stresses or the force, internal forces are there at XX as vertical component and a horizontal component, we can show it either as a normal component and a radial component. Normal component means normal to the cross section at XX and perpendicular parallel to the cross section at XX, tangential to the cross section at XX. So let NX and QX be the normal component and the tangential component, okay, or the radial component at X. So we know that if that angle is theta at X, then NX makes an angle of theta with HX and VX makes an angle of theta with, or QX make an angle of theta with VX. So we'll name VX as the vertical shear force at section XX, NX as a normal thrust at section X, QX as a radial shear force at section X, and HX as the horizontal thrust at section X. So if you are asked to determine the radial shear force and the horizontal thrust, you can do that using the, if you know VX and HX, you can directly get NX and QX from this equation. NX is equal to VX sin theta plus HX cos theta. How do you get that equation? You take the equilibrium at that point, right? So there are four forces, two components, right? VX and HX, which can be resolved into NX and QX, right? So that way you can determine this, and QX is equal to VX sin theta minus HX cos theta. Let us do one problem. A three hinged arch, hinged at supports and at the crown, has a span of 25 meters and a central rise of 5 meters. It carries a concentrated load of 40 kN at a distance of 18 meters from the left support and a UDL of 20 kN per meter over the left half portion. Determine the moment, thrust and radial shear at a section 6 meters from the left support. So to start off, we know there will be vertical and horizontal reactions at the supports. Now the horizontal reactions will be equal and opposite because there are no other reactions in the vertical direction or other forces acting in the vertical direction. So coming to the equations of equilibrium for the entire arch as a whole, sigma f of x equal to 0 will give you HA is equal to HB, let it be equal to H. Now sigma f of y equal to 0 equation will give you VA plus VB is equal to 20 into 12.5 is half the span wherein this 20 kilonewton meter is acted upon plus 40 kilonewton. Now moment about the point A equal to 0 will give you VB into 25 produces an anti-clockwise moment. I have taken anti-clockwise as negative, so minus VB into 25 plus 40 into 18 is the distance from A, and 40 kilonewton produces a clockwise moment. So plus 40 into 18 plus 20 into 12.5 is the total load due to 20 kilonewton per meter UDL into 12.5 by 2, and we can equate that equal to 0. So from here we'll be getting the value of VB as 91.3 kilonewtons. Now from the equation of sigma f of y equal to 0, we'll be calculating VA equal to 198.7 kilonewtons. Now we have the equation HA is equal to HB is equal to H. Now to determine H, let us consider the moment about the point C equal to 0. C is the internal hinge, and let us consider the right hand side of the arch because that is an easier part. The other side you have the UDL, here you are having only the point load, right? You can take any of the sides. So right here I am taking the right hand side. So what will be the equation? VB into 12.5, it is negative, I have taken anticlockwise negative, plus 40 into 18 minus 12.5. What is 18 minus 12.5? 18 is from A to the point 40 kilonewton force, and 12.5 is from A to C. So the distance between 40 kilonewton and C is 18 minus 12.5. It produces a clockwise moment. So positive 40 into 18 minus 12.5 plus H into 5. Again, it produces a clockwise moment, and the vertical distance is 5 meters, which is a perpendicular distance. Now equal to 0 will give you H is equal to 184.25 kilonewtons. Okay, so we got all the reactions VA, VB and H. Now to determine the rise at D, because we need YD to determine the moment thrust and the radial shear, right? So how will you determine YD? You have the equation for parabola as 4YC by L square into X into L minus X. So what is YC? YC is nothing but the rise, which is given as 5 meters. L is the span, which is given as 25 meters. And X is the section where we are finding the distance Y, right? So that is 6 meters. And L minus X is 25 minus 6. You will be getting YD as 3.65 meters. So now what is the moment at the point D? Moment at the point D, you take the free body diagram from A to D. Okay, I have not drawn it, but you can always draw it by yourself. So MD is equal to VA into 6, a clockwise moment, right, due to VA. Then H produces an anticlockwise moment, minus HA into YD. Then you have this 20 kilonewton acting upon up to 6 meters, right? So what will be the moment due to this 20 kilonewton? That will be 20 into 6 into 6 by 2. Okay, so that again produces a anti-clockwise moment. Okay, so from this equation you will be getting the value of MD as 160 kilonewton meters. To determine the horizontal thrust and the radial shear at a distance 6 meters from the left support, let us consider the free body diagram of the left side of at the section D. So what is the equation that we have derived for N and Q? N is equal to, so now what we need is the thrust at D. So ND is equal to VD, which is the vertical shear at D, into sine theta D plus HD into cos theta D. Theta D is the tangential, the angle the tangent makes with the horizontal at the point D. Okay, and similarly QD is also derived as VD cos theta D minus HD sine theta D. So in order to do get the values of ND and QD, what we need is VD, theta D and HD. So how will you get tan theta D? From the equation, tan theta D is equal to 4YC divided by L square into L minus 2X. What is YC? YC is the rise at the central span at C. So that we know is 5 meters. L is the total span, which is 25 meters, also given. And x is the distance where we want to find out theta, right? So that distance is 6 meters. The section D is at a distance of 6 meters from the support. So what is theta D? Tan inverse of this, and we'll get that as 22.59 degrees. Now what we need is VD. How will you get VD? VD is from sigma f of y equal to 0 of this free body diagram. So VD is nothing but VA minus 20 into 6. What is that? 198.7 is VA minus 120, that is 20 into 6, which will get as 78.7. So what is the value for ND? Now how will you get HD? HD is nothing but HA. No equations required, right? Fx, sigma f of x equal to 0 will directly give you HD is equal to HA. So what is ND? ND, just substitute in the above equation, you will be getting it as 200.35 kilonewtons, and QD as 1.885 kilonewtons. For the previous question, if you are asked to draw the bending moment diagram for the given set of loading and to determine the position and magnitude of the maximum bending moment over the arch, you have to first get the moment equation. So for that, let us cut one section. You remember how you calculate the moment equation for a regular beam, right? You will be cutting sections and finding out the moment equilibrium, right, at the cut section. So similarly, let us cut the section x6. This is the free body diagram to the left hand side. 184.4 kilonewton is the horizontal thrust we calculated initially in the previous problem, and 198.7 is the vertical reaction at A. So you'll be having mx, hx and vx. Mx is the moment at section x, hx is the horizontal thrust at section x, and vx is the vertical shear. So considering the moment equilibrium, what will be the equation? Minus mx, because it is an anti-clockwise moment, plus 198.7 into x, which is a clockwise moment, minus 184.24 into y, again an anti-clockwise moment, minus 20 into x squared by 2 due to UDL, which is again an anti-clockwise moment, is equal to 0. The net moment is 0. And that equation is a equation in two variables, x and y. So you convert y in terms of x using the equation that you already have for a parabola. Y is equal to 4yc by l square into x into l minus x, and you'll get y is equal to 4 into 5 divided by 25 square. 5 is nothing but the rise at c, which is your yc, and 25 is the span l. X is the distance where you need the bending moment, so it's a variable, and into 25 minus x. So you get y is equal to 0.8x minus 0.032 x squared. What happens to the moment equation? Now if you rearrange the equation, you will be getting mx is equal to 198.7x minus 184.24 into 0.8x minus 0.032 x squared. That is the value for y, minus 20 into x squared by 2. Or rearranging, again simplifying, you will get it as 51.308x minus 4.104 x square, which is again a quadratic equation. Now you substitute the value of x is equal to 0 in this equation. What is the value of moment? 0. So that is correct, right? At support A, the moment is 0. Similarly, you substitute the value of x is equal to 12.5, that is at the center point. What is there at the center? It is the internal hinge. And the moment has to be equal to 0. And so you can always use this as a check, right, and see whether you are getting 0. If not, then there is some problem with your equation. You have to correct your equation. Now the next point is to get the bending moment, maximum bending moment. How will you get maximum bending moment? Where dm by dx is equal to 0, right? So d by dx of 51.308x minus 4.104 x square is equal to 0. What is that? 51.308 minus 2x, right? So 2 into 4.104, that is 8.208x is equal to 0, or x is equal to 6.25 meters from the support A. So that is where the maximum bending moment occurs. Now what is the magnitude? Magnitude at x is equal to 26.25 is, substitute the value of x in the moment equation, mx equation, right? So that is 51.308 into 6.25 minus 4.105 into 6.25 square, which you will get as 160 kilonewton meters. So whatever we saw in the previous slide was to the maximum bending moment happening between the section A to C, where it is a UDL acting, and that section is was valid from 0 to 12.5, that is from A to C. Now, from to draw the bending moment diagram of the section B to C, we need actually two sections, right? Because there is a load in between. So we have to cut one section which is from B to D and another section which is from D to C. Okay, so let us first cut a section from B to D. So this is the free body diagram of the section. You are having 91.3 and 184.4, and then you have MX, HX, VX at section 11, X and Y. So this section, the value of X is valid from 0 to 7 meters. 7 meters is where this point D is, right? Up to D it is 7 meters from the support B. So taking the moment equilibrium at section XX, MX, which is a clockwise moment, minus 91.3 into X, which is a anti-clockwise moment, then plus 184.24 into Y, which produces a clockwise moment, is equal to 0. So again, you have Y is equal to 0.8X minus 0.032X squared. So we'll be getting MX is equal to 91.3X minus 184.24 into 0.8X minus 0.032X squared. Simplifying, you will be getting 5.85x square minus 56.092x, which is a quadratic equation. Now you put x is equal to 0, that is the support B, right? What happens? Are you getting mx equal to 0? Then correct, right? And at x is equal to 7, what is the value? You have to calculate the value of mx, that is just beneath the load. What is that value? If you substitute that value of x as 7 in the equation, you will be getting it as 103.7 kilonewton meters. Okay. Now we need the second section, which is between D and C. So let X2 be the section between D and C. Where is X valid from? X will be valid from 7 to 12.5, right? So this is the free body diagram of the section. So you have an additional 40 kilonewton for load that is acting, right? And it is valid from 7 to 12.5 meters. So taking again the moment equilibrium, MX minus 91.3X plus 184.25y plus 40 into x minus 7. Okay, that is the additional value that is coming when compared to the previous one. Now that is equal to 0. Again, put y value of y in terms of x. You will be getting mx is equal to 5.85x square minus 96.092x plus 280. Okay, again a quadratic equation. Now at x is equal to 12.5 meters, what is the value of mx? That is, x is equal to 12.5 means it's an internal hinge. Are you getting a 0? Then it is correct, right? And at x is equal to 7, you should get the same value as you got in the previous one. What is that value? 103.7 kilonewton meters. If you are getting this, it is actually a check on whether you have taken the equations correctly. Now we have to draw the bending moment diagram. Now let us draw the bending moment diagram. So drawing the bending moment diagram is similar to that of a simply supported beam. Okay, so you just don't have to worry. So in section X6, the limit was valid from 0 to 12.5, and x was 0 at x is equal to 0 and x is equal to 12.5. We got mx is equal to 0, and the maximum bending moment we got as 160 kilonewton meters. So that was this arch, and this was the section X6. So how will be the bending moment diagram? Just imagine A to C as A is a hinge and C is a hinge, so it is a simply supported beam. Okay, so now just imagine that you are having a UDL. So how will be the load acting? It will be and again you got 6.25, you got it as 160 kilonewton meters as the maximum value, so you'll be getting it like this. So from A to C, it is just like WL squared by 8. You remember, it's just a parabolic case, WL squared by 8. Similar to that, I'm not saying that it is WL squared by 8, it is changing because this is the shape of the bending moment diagram. Now, from C to B, it will be a straight line because there is no load acting. So what you are supposed to actually do is, you have to cut a new section X3 at CB. For this loading alone, when 20 kilonewton meter per meter is acting at this point alone, so you'll be getting a linear shape like this. Okay, and you can always find out dm by dx from where you'll be getting the maximum negative moment also. I've not done this here because I've got both UDL and the concentrated load acting, so I've got lots of maximum moments coming up. That is why I've not drawn it. But only if this UDL has been asked in the question, then you have to find out the negative bending moment also. which will be maximum between C and B. So this is the bending moment diagram for section XX. Now section X1, X1 and X2, X2, we have this what point load acting, right? This is the sections X1, X1 and X2, X2. So here it will be like this. Just imagine from B to C as a simply supported beam and you are having a point load. How will be the bending moment diagram? It will be a triangular shaped load, right? Or else you can use Eddy's theorem. You get the profile of the funicular polygon and you can just apply it on here, okay? So you got the maximum moment as 103.7 kilonewton meters, okay? So do it separately, do the bending moment diagram separately and just say that add up these two to get the value of. So just draw these two and put a plus sign to get the total bending moment diagram of the entire arch section. Now let us say you are asked to determine the draw the normal thrust diagram. Normal thrust is nothing but the axial compression diagram. So you may be asked to draw the axial diagram, axial force diagram, and the shear force diagram, V diagram for this one. You have the free body diagram. What is Nx is the axial compression, right? So you have to calculate Nx at critical locations and Vx at the critical locations. We are asked to get the shear force. Sometimes you will be asked to draw the radial shear force diagram. In that condition, you have to calculate Qx. If it is a vertical shear force, then you have to calculate Vx only. Okay. So what is the equation for Nx? Nx is equal to Vx sin theta x plus Hx cos theta x. So what you should do is to determine N at critical locations. How will you identify critical locations? Either if you are drawing the bending moment diagram, you will be getting the locations as 0, 6.25, 12.5, in the section A and 0 and 7 in section B. We have done that because of that. Otherwise, what you should do is, if you are getting directly to, if you are asked directly to draw only the normal thrust diagram, shear force diagram, then you take mid span and quarter spans. Okay, if it is a UDL, you take first x is equal to 0, then 12.5 by 2. How much is that? That value, then 12.5. Then in the right hand side you are actually having a point load, so just below the point load one, that is 7 meters, and then at the support B, that is x is equal to 0 from B. Okay, that is how you determine the critical locations. Nothing much very difficulty in that. So how will you estimate Vx? Vx we can estimate from the equation sigma f of y equal to 0 and Hx from the equation sigma f of x equal to 0. It's not that difficult for at any section. So at x is equal to 0, you've calculated Hx and Vx. At h is equal to 6.25, you calculate Hx and Vx like that. Okay, and how will you get theta x? From this equation, tan inverse of 4yc by L square into L minus 2x. So it is just, you have to apply the, or you have to do lots of calculations to get the values. Yeah. So I've put that in a tabular column. So let us take the sections from A. Okay, from A, when x is equal to 0, at x is equal to 0, what is the value of Vx? Vx is nothing but Va, right? That is 198.7. And what is the value of Hx? Hx is nothing but Ha. And what is theta x? Theta x you can provide x is equal to 0 in the theta equation. You will be getting it as 38.65. Similarly, at 6.25, how will be the free body diagram? You are having a UDL also, right? You remember the free body diagram we did? So the same diagram. So Va minus 20 into 6.25, because the UDL is also coming into picture. So that comes out as 73.7. Ha is the same as H itself, no other horizontal force, so 184.24. And theta you provide x is equal to 6.25 in the theta equation. You will get it as 21.8. Similarly, at 12.5 I have calculated, and from B I have taken it x is equal to 0 from B. Okay, so you have to take the free body diagram of the right hand side. So if you take the free body diagram of the right hand side, you will be getting at 0, Vx is equal to Vb itself, which is 91.3. And at 7, it will be Vb minus 40, which is 51.3. And at 12.5, it will be Vb minus 40 again, which is 51.3. Okay, and Ha everywhere, it is going to be the same. And theta, always you can apply the equation and get the value. Now you just apply, put these values in this equation. Nx is equal to Vx sin theta x plus Hx cos theta x to get the value of Nx. Now let us try to draw the normal thrust and the, that is the axial force diagram and the shear force diagram. So first I'll just put the critical locations, I'll just put the vertical lines. Now to draw the shear force diagram, this is how the shear force diagram will be, right? So at B it is 91.3 and at A it is 198.7, okay? So and at this point, at C it is 51.3 and at 7 meters as well as at 12.5 meters it is 51.3. So it's a constant between this. You just imagine it's just simply like a simply supported beam that we've done in mechanics of solids. So just the similar way you try to draw the shear force diagram, and then you can draw the axial force diagram, that is the Nx values. Whatever we drew was the Vx values. Now for the Nx values, these are all positive values for Nx because it is all axial compression. In shear, we know that it changes from A to B as we go, right? So axial force, it is 268, 198, 184, 201, 191 and 184. Okay, so 184 to 184, it is a constant, right? At VB is equal to 40, at 12.5, sorry, not at 184, it's not a constant. From 184, it is increasing to 191, okay? So this is the axial force diagram. Usually, this may not be asked for the exam, but in case if it is asked, you should know how to draw it. What they ask is, given at a given section, find out the normal thrust, shear stress, shear force, radial force, like that, okay? Even the bending moment diagram, sometimes only they'll ask, but they may ask. But normal thrust and shear force diagrams, I'm not sure whether they'll ask, but it's always better that you understand and keep ready so that you'll be able to draw that. Now, this is the typical bending moment for a UDL and a 4-point load which are acting separately. So, if your question is to draw the bending moment diagram for the UDL alone, the question is the first one alone. Then, as I've told earlier also, you have to calculate the positive maximum bending moment and the location of positive maximum bending moment. Similarly, you have to calculate the negative maximum bending moment and the position of negative maximum bending moment, similar to the case of point load also. So, you just remember this bending moment diagrams. It's not that difficult to remember. So, if you have that, even though you are not calculating the values, at least draw the figure and keep it. Okay, that show that this is the bending moment diagram. And at the point of maximum minimum, you know for a point load, it will be exactly below the point load, the maximum moment. So that you can calculate by x is equal to whatever that distance is, right? So just put that for a case of point load and draw the bending moment diagram. It is not very difficult. But for the UDL, you may not be able to exactly give the location, but always you can draw this figure, okay? It is always better you learn how to draw the bending moment diagram, but in case if you are finding it difficult, then at least try to remember these figures.